Akufo-Addo bring about economic changes so that the entire Ghana can feel the benefits of being a middle-income country.
Equipping our people with the skills to run a modern economy, that is the central feature that we have to influence.
I can see the colors of the rainbow, and I can feel the sun on my face. I see the light at the end of the tunnel.
Hello viewers and welcome to Amazing Series. This is your host Ama and I'm going to introduce you to a man who is poised to become the next president of Ghana. His name is Nana Akufo-Addo. He is a man who's poised to become the next president of Ghana. He's going to share with us his insight on the Ghanaian political situation, and he's also going to share with us the 35 years of experience that he's had, how Africa can move forward. Please help me welcome Nana Akufo-Addo. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
Nana, August 7th was a fantastic day for you. And as I say it, I can see you're glowing already because you had a decisive win on August 7th. For our viewers who are not aware, NPP is the main opposition party of Ghana. Now, Nana Akufo-Addo on August the 7th won 80% of the votes cast for their aspiring presidential candidates. Now, this was a historic win in Africa because out of the 107,000 votes cast, you won 80%. How did that moment feel like? You have to share it with us.
Well, first of all, very humbling. I never anticipated that I would get such a vote. I had hoped and thought I would win, but the size of the victory really took my breath away. And it's a humbling moment. I mean, you just suddenly realize, especially when you realize that so many people put their faith in you to help them in a situation. It's quite a humbling experience.
Nana, as I mentioned, you've had over 35 years experience in politics. And in 2007, the campaign year, your slogan was actually Yinimu Fritite, because Ghanaians really associate you with politics and the NPP. And I think in many ways, Ghanaians see you as a presidential figure. So everybody is eagerly awaiting 2012 from when you touch the pulse of the Ghanaian society right now. But I wanted you to help address the notion that sometimes, like you know, because you've been around for a long time and you've been active in political life, you're waiting in the wings and there's the notion that you always have to, it's your turn as opposed to it's a meritocracy. How would you address that issue?
I don't think that the idea is that it's a question of it being your turn. I think what we're seeing in our country are two things. First of all, the Ghanaian people want to be sure that they have a good idea of who you are, so that somebody coming in brand new and just bursting onto the scene doesn't attract them so much. They want to be able to be sure that they know the material that they're promoting. And that is why you have to be around someone for them to have it. And then secondly, there's also the whole business of the timing. I mean, in 2000, our president who had been around, our leader then, the then candidate Jay Akufo, caught the mood of the people that the time was ripe for change. I believe that that is also what happened in 2008. And then you represent the forces that are seeking the change. And that is the way you come through. I don't think the question is a question of it's somebody's turn. I don't believe that that is the attitude. The issue of the knowledge of the candidate and also the circumstances of the time, that's what really determines how the decision is made.
So speaking about the mood of the people, do you sense, as the same way that I've been gathering, that people are really in need of changing? Do you have that sense as well?
I think so, because I think there's been a tremendous disappointment with the performance of our current president, who was the change candidate of 2008. The performance of he and his government has not been particularly good, and the Ghanaian people sense that. A series of promises that have not been fulfilled has also undermined his credibility. And these are the reasons why the strong feeling for change that you have identified is blowing through Ghana at the moment.
Nana, you touched on the mood of the people. Can you please share with us your take on the current political and economic situation in Ghana?
Unfortunately for us, the economy that expanded a great deal in the Kufuor's time, is beginning to shrink, largely as a result of the policies of the Mills administration. And what does that mean? The shrinking of an economy means harder times for those who are in that economy. And that is going across the board. We're talking about business people, we're talking about working people, we're talking about market women and traders, we're talking about fisher folk, we're talking about the whole broad spectrum of Ghanaian workforce as having a lot of difficulties in meeting their ordinary obligations, largely because the economy is shrinking. So the focus has to be on the things that we need to expand our economy. We're not going to be able to expand our economy significantly unless we begin to change the nature of the Ghanaian economy. And that is the message, the most important part of the message that I want to put before the Ghanaian people, that the time has come for us to look at the measures we need to take to transform the nature of our economy. We produce basically just raw materials, cocoa, gold, timber, and we've now got another raw material, oil. We will never be able to prosper as a nation if we continue to be a raw material producing country. All the countries in the world that have attained prosperity are those countries that are industrial economies. So the challenge for us, and that is going to be hopefully the theme of my presidency, is what we need to do to industrialize the Ghanaian economy. I think the ingredients are now in place for us to be able to do so. Obviously, a lot of work has to come forward. A great deal of planning has to go into it. But that is the fundamental objective of what would be an Akufo-Addo presidency, the process for transforming the structure of the Ghanaian economy, to move us to an economy that doesn't depend on the production and export of raw materials, but on value-added activities. We can do it. We are part of a huge market in West Africa. 300 million people on the ECOWAS market. If we work to make that market really functional, we have a place in which we can sell our manufactured products. So I am seeing Ghana as a base for light industrial, light manufacturing activity, destined essentially for this 300 million plus ECOWAS market. I believe that is the way to prosperity for our people. And that is what will be able to change the circumstances of life of the ordinary Ghanaian.
Nana, I touched on your immense political experience. I know it's all limited to Ghana. It's, you know, throughout the entire Africa and beyond. I think you're the perfect person to ask the question, which is, how has Ghana been able to avoid the political fate that has befallen countries like Ivory Coast, Guinea, and even Kenya?
Well, you're talking about our history. First of all, the people who began the struggle for independence for Ghana were careful to go down the path of, if you like, peaceful struggle. We never had armed conflict here in Ghana. We didn't use guns to chase the British out. We used our mouth and our sense of organization. And I think that that has in some ways determined the way in which our country has progressed. That despite the various military interventions, Ghanaian people have seen the value of peaceful political activity. I think that is one of the most important things that has brought about the situation that we are in now. Secondly, once again as a result of the history, these difficulties that we had with the various military interventions has meant that our people appreciate the democratic model very much. So in returning to democracy in 1992, we have seen the longest unbroken period of political stability in our country. All of us understanding that at the end of the day, Rome cannot be built in a day, so it is worth the whole process of waiting for change, doing it through the ballot box, doing it without spilling blood. I think that we have been lucky, but I also think that it's a lot of it is the genius of the Ghanaian people. There's something particular, I don't know, I mean, it sounds very, perhaps very chauvinistic, or that I believe strongly that there is something about the Ghanaian makeup, the Ghanaian psyche, that means that we are there to be, if you like, the beacon the lodestar for Africa's development. It was not an accident that we were the first country, sub-Saharan Africa, to gain its freedom. And since then, the developments in our country have been the benchmark by which the rest of Africa has conducted itself. I think all of this, as I say, is a manifestation of the Ghanaian genius. And it is that Ghanaian genius that is propelling us towards this brighter future, which I think awaits us.
Nanado, we're going to shift gears and go into the economy now. Ghana recently attained middle income status, but many Ghanaians are not feeling the benefits of this new status. How would President Akufo-Addo bring about economic changes so that the entire Ghana can feel the benefits of being a middle income country?
I think there are two or three things that we have to concentrate on. First of all, equipping our people to run a modern economy. The economy that we have today, where 60% of our people are illiterate, we're never going to prosper that way. So a key issue is education, how we can equip our people with the skills that would allow them to run a modern economy. Secondly, understanding the fact that it is only by changing the structure of our economy that we can grow Ghana. We can't continue to be exporting raw materials from Ghana if Ghana wants to be prosperous. No country has become prosperous from living off raw materials. So the skill set that we need to run an industrial or industrializing economy is key. The kind of policies that the central government has to do. But beyond that, the encouragement that the central government gives to ordinary Ghanaians so how they can better their lives, for me, is a central issue. Because that is what you want to do. You want to create a society where every Ghanaian feels there's an opportunity for him or herself to do better for themselves. If we create that, the atmosphere, and we do it by encouraging good role models. The whole business of sniping at people who are successful, it doesn't help. On the contrary, they should be held up as the models for people to aim at. But crucially, equipping our people with the skills to run a modern economy. That is the central feature that we have to advance.
So what would you actually, it would be a good opportunity for you to elaborate on something that you really believe this would be a great opportunity for you to elaborate on something that I know you're really passionate about, which is the new society of opportunities. What is it, Nana?
What is it? Very simply, if you haven't gone to school, you have the opportunity to go to school. If you have a small business, it's a one-man business, what the central government can do, by way of policy, by way of assisting people with credit, making sure the credit goes, how you transform a one-man business into a two or a three-man business. When we're talking about opportunity, that's exactly what we need. Those who do not have the skills are given the opportunity to acquire them. Those that have already, you give them the opportunity to improve on what the small businesses that make up the bulk of our economy, what we need to do to strengthen people in those businesses. This is what we're talking about when we're talking about the new society of opportunities, that every Ghanaian is given the opportunity to aspire to a better life, and that the central government acts as some sort of, catalyst sounds like a big word, but as the person that facilitates these opportunities being spread out through the society. And I think if you have a government whose attitude is that what we need to do is to help people help themselves, i.e. give them a hand up, not so much handouts. You transform the culture, you transform the spirit of your time, and you make it easier for people to work for themselves. By doing so, create prosperity for themselves and then for the larger society of which they're a part. That's the way I'm looking at it. And I think that is the way forward for Ghana.
Nana, talking about a society of opportunities, you know, expectations are at their peak high because Ghana